Good morning, everyone. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning. We're actually up, we're somewhere in North Carolina. We're over at Mark Connolly's place in North Carolina, and we're sitting right outside his training center. We haven't even pulled in yet. We just, we haven't even said hello. Well, we said a quick hello, but other than that, we got here just in time to do the show at 11 a.m. We wanted to make sure that it went on the air. Let me know if there is any voice issues, crackling. Yesterday we did the show already. We did it from where were we? South Carolina. We did it from Greenville, South Carolina. And after I uploaded the show to my producer, we found out that 20 minutes in, the show was crackling, which means, and it sounded okay in my headphones, which means it was a microphone to computer issue, which I wouldn't have picked up, but right now everything is sounding fine. So if you're on the air right now and if you hear crackling, let me know, because then it's a whole different story and we're not sure what we're going to do. But what you can do is, if you have not been following my my journey and Linda's journey of rvdogtrainer.com, you know that we're actually up on our 10,000th mile. It originally was going to be an 8,000 mile trip. We've been making a lot of side trips, though, when we don't have to get somewhere right away. For instance, Mark Connolly, who we know from Facebook group. We've never met before, but we've gone back and forth on Facebook and different dog training forums. Morgan, sounding great to me too. Awesome. Thank you so much. Morgan, you're in charge of sound today. you're in charge of sound. It's a big responsibility. So thank you very much. So everything sounds good. If it sounds good to you, that means it will sound good in the final format. So that's really, really great. Okay. You can chat if you're listening to this. Melissa, thank you so much. Hi, Jeff. Sounds okay right now. Actually, Linda, talk.
Hi. How are you doing, Melissa?
Talk a little bit more.
Okay. I'll talk a little bit more. Okay. Feeling good today. Okay. Getting ready for a big day.
Okay, good. So hopefully Linda's voice also sounds good as well. And we're going to have to move different things around so we can pick up Linda's voice. All right. So what you can do is if you're watching the show live right now, what you can do is you can type in your questions right in the chat box and I'll get to them. A lot of people have been emailing me, Facebook messaging me, YouTube. It's really funny because YouTube, I went onto YouTube last night just to check one of the videos that I just put up, and we've broke 1 million viewers on YouTube, on our YouTube channel. And about 3,000 people a day watch our videos. So which means is now getting to 2 million will be much quicker. So I've been on YouTube for a long time. Melissa said, Linda's so pretty, sounds great. Linda is a stunning, sexy woman. It is incredible that she's my life partner. And I'm so honored to have her traveling with me now. And I know she's about at the end of her rope, though. This is it, right?
Some people would say I'm two clips short of going postal. Have you ever heard that term before?
Yeah, we shouldn't probably joke about shootings.
I know, but you know what I'm saying.
I know.
I'm a little bit frayed at the edges.
Yeah, it's time. Yeah. But and we're in cold weather. It's been going down to single digits now. Actually, right now it's actually pretty nice outside. It's about 40 degrees outside.
Oh, it's warm.
It's warmer. Last night we slept in single digit weather. Don't worry, we're fine. That we can keep the RV above 50. And
my feet fell off, but other than that, and we're all like struggling a little bit with a cold now too.
Yeah, I'm so feeling a little bit better now.
Yeah, I think I'm feeling good.
So we did a seminar up in our last seminar we did was in Gainesville, Florida, and if you want to know where our seminars are going, if you go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, you'll see that our next seminar is in Baltimore, Maryland. It's actually Sunday. There's still spots available. After that, we're actually doing an RV Dog Trainer seminar in Providence. It's a two-day seminar. This one seminar, though, is only open to dog owners. I would say about, and not because I don't want to train dog trainers in Providence. I train tons of dog trainers in Providence. In fact, we have dog trainers now. We have a new program in Providence. We have a new program in Providence where any of the folks that have gone through my T3 program can come in on a Sunday and actually work with John, in shadowing John on Sundays and working with dogs. So if you're interested in that, and if you're not familiar with what T3 is train the trainers with Sean and Jeff. So anybody that has gone through our train the trainers program that wants to come in on Sunday, we just figure that's a good day to come in on. Most people have to, you know, they've got Sundays off. You can come in on a Sunday, watch John do his group class, and then also work with our boarding trains, and maybe even bring one of your dogs with you that you're struggling with. And we offer that on Sundays. There's obviously going to be a fee for that. But give us a call. Call my office. You'll talk to Cameron about setting that up. So we stayed in Greenville for 2 nights at a wonderful hostess, Sabina and Emilio's house in Greenville in a beautiful log cabin and overlooking, actually, I guess it wasn't overlooking the mountains because we actually looked up to see the mountains, mm-hmm. but it's up a little bit, halfway up, halfway down, but boy, was it fantastic.
You know that's my dream home, right?
Yeah, I do, a log cabin. All right, well, stop spending so much money and put that money away instead, and you can help contribute towards the down payment of the dream home. That's all I can say is if you want to shop for a log cabin, you got to stop shopping for other stuff.
Wow, put me in my place.
I'm just letting you know.
Put me in my place.
I'm just letting you know. So the Greenville, we all stopped at the Greenville shelter. There's a Greenville animal shelter. I'm going to be putting the videos together now. I'm going to be editing the videos. I edit a small video and I put it up on one of my private Facebook groups for the dog trainers to see. But I'm going to be putting together probably about a 10 or 12 minute video of something I would do it in an animal shelter. Now, it's been about 2 years since I've been into an animal shelter. Actually, if you all remember the brick video, that's the last time I was in an animal shelter. And I did that out of a personal favor for someone. The reason why I don't go into animal shelters is this. Animal shelters are political, egotistical, and they actually really don't care about the dogs. They're married to a methodology of this quote unquote positive dog training. I use a ton of reward-based training in my training. I use food, I use praise, I use play, I use physical touch, all those things. I actually use all four quadrants, and I'm not going to get into science here, but if someone wants to say they use science-based training and they never correct a dog or have a consequence for a dog, they're actually outright lying to you. They are liars. They are liars, and they are unethical. So there's no such thing as pure positive, and we can talk all day long about this, but we don't need to because everything has a consequence in life. Everything. Name it, it has a consequence in life. All right? So why do you close your door of your home? Because you don't want your dog to run outside. That's not positive. That's a consequence. So the door has to be closed so the dog doesn't run outside. So many different things. Anyway, we're called balanced trainers. Now, balanced trainers correct dogs, and there's a consequence for unacceptable, bad, and dangerous behavior. How high is the consequence? We don't know. The dog tells us. Sometimes the consequences has to be higher if the dog doesn't stop with a lower consequence. In the meantime, we're also obviously training and praising the dog. I forgot to start my timer on this because we're on a different program right now, so I need to figure out how long I've been talking for. So I guess I can go by the timer on that. That's what I'll do. I'll go by the timer. We started it right at 11 o'clock. So number one, we're going to stop at 11:13. So I'm doing a seminar there in the spring at the Greenville Animal Shelter. And this is the thing. I did a small little demo there for one dog. All I used was a slip lead. That one little demo using a slip lead, I didn't talk to the dog one time. I used no words to the dog at all. I don't even know the dog's name, and it doesn't matter what the dog's name is. All I used was a slip lead and my energy and my body. That's it. This dog did better in 30 seconds than it's done since it's been there. It's simple stuff, guys. It's dog training. It's dog training. What happens with a lot of dog trainers is they want to make it look like they're these highly intelligent, well-educated, college-degreed, certificate-based, yada, 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 yada. Guys, let me in on a little secret. They're dogs. We're just training them. We're training them to do what we want, and we're stopping them from doing what they don't want. Okay? There are 10-year-old and 12-year-old dog trainers out there that can blow me away. They can blow a lot of dog trainers away. Okay? Okay? So it's going to be really, really important that hold on 1 second. Girls, you're going to have to keep it quiet. So,
thank you.
Okay, yeah. Transparency. Usually the girls are in the master bedroom of the RV. This time they're up on their beds, so they're talking a little bit loud. And again, if you're watching this, you would have just seen what would have happened. And we just threw 3 soda bottles at their heads. Okay, that's a joke. No, we didn't. We wouldn't do that. Number one, we don't drink soda. Number two, we would never throw anything at our children. All right? So, but we do tell them to be quiet. Why? Because their behavior was not acceptable, so be quiet was a correction, and the consequence, guess what? They stopped talking. It's the same thing. It is the exact same thing. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a seminar there in the spring. Could you imagine? Actually, we're going to take a quick break, and let me tell you about this exciting seminar we're going to be doing in Greenville, South Carolina, for an animal shelter that intakes 21,000 dogs a year that go through there. It's going to be a low-cost seminar. We're going to adopt out dogs. We are going to adopt out trained dogs. You'll be able to go there on Sunday afternoon and adopt a trained dog. It's going to be fantastic. We're going to take a quick break. Please don't yawn in front of the camera. Please just don't. It's on video.
Jeff, what am I supposed to do?
I don't know.
Swallow it?
Yes, absolutely. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning. Actually, today, what is today? Today's Friday. Today's Friday, and you're going to be listening to the show on Saturday, unless you're watching it right now. And the way we're doing these shows is while we're on the road, we're really trying to put together a live show every week. And what we're doing is we're recording these shows on video, and then we're submitting them to our producer. Actually, we're submitting them to my wonderful assistant, Melissa, and she's actually then turning them into a usable format for Brett to use at the radio show. So imagine this. Imagine a 2-day seminar at an animal shelter, and imagine 20 to 30 people show up, and they all have to pay $200. All right. Then what we do is we start bringing dogs out of the animal shelter. We do a little bit of theory, showing people how to do basic commands. So I'll probably take one dog out of the animal shelter. Then everybody grabs a dog from the animal shelter. Maybe we'll do 10 at a time just to keep it safe. Everybody starts working on walking properly on a leash, sit, place, down, and recall. And then start instituting calm on command protocols. Then think about people working on the off-leash training. Then people start working on no jumping, right? Going in and out of the crate, eliminating separation anxiety, and starting off-leash protocols. Imagine that. Think about that. After 2 days of training, they use a prison population there. We're going to get the prisoners involved there as well, because we want the prisoners to really get heavily involved. Because right now, all the prisoners are doing is they're cleaning up the kennels, they're moving the dogs around. Then what we're going to do on day 2 is, at the end of the day, people that want to adopt a dog can come to the shelter, and we'll have either the prisoners or we'll have the people that have been attending show the dogs off on their skills, and then these people could be adopting a not fully trained dog, but boy, in 2 days, believe it or not, in 2 days, we can make dramatic change. They will pay a higher adoption fee. Why? Because they should pay a higher adoption fee. All that money then goes to the animal shelter, and we'll probably clear out 50 dogs in one day. Then all the people that were working those 2 days, plus the prisoners, will have learned new skills and they can start instituting all those new protocols. Could you imagine that? Now. I did most of the stuff with just a basic slip lead. But this shelter is open to different training tools, prong collars or remote collars. This is what's going to happen. As soon as we announce this seminar, every a-hole out there that doesn't like me, and there's a lot of them out there because they think I'm abusing dogs. You're just a stupid, idiot, foolish, egotistical person. You have no clue what you're talking about. You have absolutely no clue. You have no clue. All right. I almost want to challenge you to a duel, you know, like a gunslinger duel. Let's both show up, take a dog out of a shelter. After 1 hour, you show me what you're going to do. I show you what I'm going to do. Okay. Because I'm going to create calm dogs. You're going to create food, crazy, nutty, out of control dogs. That's what you're going to do. Now, that's not to say we don't use food, but we use it differently. Our food calms a dog down. The way you use food excites a dog. Since we're family dog trainers, we don't want a dog to be excited. That's another point. When you're looking for a dog trainer out there, folks, you should be looking for a dog trainer that fits the modality of your life. So I've gone to seminars with working dog trainers. That's what they specialize in. They specialize in IPO and ring sport and Schutzen. They're raising puppies. Now, the way they raise these puppies is not the way a family should be raising a puppy for a family dog training. It's two separate things. So what they do is not necessarily what we would do. So think about that. Just think about that concept. All right. So it's really important that people understand when you're working with a dog trainer, you find a dog trainer that actually can help your problem. For instance, if you go to a dog trainer and they specialize in, say, agility, that's their specialty. They are agility dog trainers. They compete in agility. They do everything they want in agility. My opinion is, if you're looking for an agility dog trainer, go to them. I would go to them. All right. I would go to them. I'm not going to teach your dog how to do agility, but guess what? If you're a family and you're looking for just a family dog, you wouldn't go to them. It's two different training ways. Okay. I've got a lot of canine officers. These are the police officers that have canine dogs. They drive around in four-door cars and SUVs that say stay back canine on them. They do all the search and rescue. They do the bite work. And they do protection. Okay. Crowd control. Guess what? If they've got a personal dog that is aggressive, some of them can do it, but a lot of them cannot fix the dog. That's not what they do. So they come to me. Okay. A lot of agility trainers come to me. They won't admit it. They don't want their picture ever taken. They won't admit it. They're embarrassed. But why would you be embarrassed? Why would you be embarrassed about that stuff? You know, it's okay to admit your faults. My dogs are not perfect. You know, that's another thing. My colleague Sean O'Shea brought up the other day in a post talking about how his dogs are not perfect. And he listed every issue he's having with his dogs. My dogs are far from perfect. I couldn't leave my dogs alone in my house. Absolutely not. You know, I couldn't leave my dogs alone in my in the RV. Absolutely not. I kennel my dogs up here. Right now that we're sitting at a table, underneath the table, I fenced it off and I've created a kennel for Girl. At night, she sleeps on the couch right next to me. During the day, if we're out of the RV or anytime we're out of the RV, she gets kenneled up. I wouldn't trust her. Why? She would chew something possibly. She possibly would destroy something. I can't have her doing that. I can't have her chewing one pillow, or God forbid she chewed a wire. This is our home. You chew one wire in an RV, you might not be able to start your engines. That would be terrible. That would be horrific. So people have got to understand, find the dog trainers. Going back to the point of all the folks, when they find out that I'm doing a seminar in anywhere, people do online petitions, They call the newspapers. They do all. They call up the shelter saying, "Don't hire this guy." You know what? You're mean, evil people. You're mean, evil people. You really don't care about the dogs. All you care about is your own, almost like a religious thing with a methodology of training, which does not work on most dogs, and they never work on dogs in animal shelters. Okay? They never work on dogs in animal shelters. Animal shelters don't have time. They need a dog to stop pulling on a leash today. Today. There are dog trainers out there that after six visits with a family dog still can't get that dog to walk on a leash. Six visits. Could you imagine that? Could you imagine? I can get a dog to walk on a leash in 30 seconds or less. 99% of the dogs presented to me in 30 seconds or less. 99% of the dogs. Almost every dog in an animal shelter, 99% of them can walk on a leash. 99% of them can stop jumping. 99% of them could sit down and place and recall in less than a day. All these dogs in animal shelters can do that. So why is it with all these people out there, the pure positive people out there, supposedly, that are advocating that their way of training is so good? And I'm not trying to start a war here, but it's like 4 million dogs a year are being killed in this country, guys. So step up. Step up. Spend more time working with the shelters. If you care so much about dogs, lose your ego, go into a shelter. Why don't I go into a shelter? Politics. Politics. That's why. I don't need the aggravation in my life. That's why. So, anyway, Carrie's got a question that she just wrote on. My dog, who is a four-year-old Wheaton Terrier, has always been nervous and fear-aggressive. There are times that trigger him to be aggressive when I believe his fear kicks in, and he has in the past month lunged and nipped at me. That's not good. I have an e-collar on him at all times now. I know I should have done that before. Don't worry about it. Don't beat yourself up. But my question is, how to best handle the outburst the right way for the dog? I don't want to create more stress for him by handling it wrong. Great question, Carrie. First of all, Carrie, I want you to be working with a trainer that understands how to use remote collars. Okay? I want you to be working with a trainer that knows how to use remote collars. Remote collars are actually fantastic to use for dogs. They are. For all of our fearful dogs, we put remote collars on almost immediately. It is low-level remote collar training is literally the least invasive way to work with a dog. The least invasive way. Why? Because there's no shocking and there's no zapping. So get off this nonsense about, shocking and zapping dogs. 99% of dog trainers out there, just like 99.9% of police officers out there, are not doing the wrong thing. They're doing the right thing. Okay? They are. They're all doing the right thing. So what I want you to do is, first of all, understand layers of stress. So layers of stress with your dog. If you've got a nervous dog that's a fear biter, this is what's going to happen. Say your dog is not comfortable with children, okay? And your dog was in down. Your dog was in place. As soon as my kids walk into your house, your dog all of a sudden gets a little bit nervous. So your dog is here. Kids walk in the house, your dog goes up to here, but it stays in the place command. You reward it with good. Then all of a sudden, my kids get a little bit closer. They sit on the couch because my kids are smart. They don't go up to dogs and pet them. And if you tell them to leave them alone, they leave them alone. Okay? What?
Check your time.
I'll check my time. I got to turn this thing on. We've got time. Then what I want you to do is, I want you to then, all of a sudden the kids start running around. And then all of a sudden your dog now escalates more. And then all of a sudden the kids sit down and start eating dinner. The dog calms down a little bit, but does not calm down all the way to the baseline. Then all of a sudden the kids are done with dinner, and it's 30 minutes later, the kids stand up and calmly walk out. And all of a sudden your dog lunges and bites at them. And you say to yourself, why? I don't understand that. I don't understand why did the dog just lunge and bite my kids? The kids have been here for 30 minutes because the layers of stress have been building up. The layers of stress have been building up. And I want you to eliminate that. I want you to eliminate that. So I want you to work on duration stuff. And when your dog gets excited, so if your dog's in place like this, and all of a sudden your dog goes like this, I want you to use a low level. I don't know what level it is going to be, but I want you to just hit the button and get your dog to go. Every time your dog gets excited, the remote should be able to calm the dog down. Remotes calm dogs down. We're going to take a quick break. This is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do? I've been talking to you live this Saturday morning. Actually, it's Friday. We pre-recorded the show. We're over here in North Carolina. We're coming right back.
We don't want this on camera.
What?
Blow my nose on camera.
You're going to have to blow your nose on camera.
I can't.
You have to. There's no other option. There's no other option. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning. Full disclosure, it's actually Friday afternoon, and we're over here at Mark Conley's place. What's the name of his company? Hold on, he's got a vehicle right there. Canine Command. Canine Command Dog Training. Go to www.caninecommand.com. And he's been dog training since 1994.
Wow.
Yeah. And he's a great guy. I know he's a great guy, and I shook his hand as soon as I got here, and I'm plugged into his barn, just so we can run electricity. We'll probably spend about an hour here.
Yeah,
we'll spend an hour here. Maybe we can order in some food. Maybe get some pizza, or maybe there's a close restaurant that we can go to. But I think that'll be great. But we definitely are heading up to Baltimore after this. If you're not part of my Facebook fan group, what you want to do is not my personal thing. Oh, by the way, thanks for all the wonderful birthday wishes. Thank you so much, everybody. My birthday was on the 7th of the month, and like, I don't know, 300 people or so did a happy birthday. And I responded back to everybody. It's not nuts. But if you're going to take the time to wish me a happy birthday,
I feel like I can't keep up with that.
Well, I could. It was hard. You got to dedicate the time.
Yeah.
Guys. Okay, I read every one of your messages. Every one of your messages that you write on my Facebook page, I read and I try to like. I love you guys. I'm madly in love with you guys.
How old are you, Jeff?
I'm 40.
You're 29.
No, I'm 49. I'm 49.
Okay. You're looking good.
Yeah, I'm damn right. I'm looking good. And you know what else? So we've been on the road for 2 months. I have not been exercising as much as I want, but I definitely have been exercising. So the house we stayed at had a scale in the bathroom.
Oh, I didn't get on it. Did you?
I got on it. Guess what? You ready for this? 2 months on the road. 2 months on the road.
You've lost weight.
Barbecue beyond belief.
If you tell me you lost weight, I'm going to punch you.
Barbecue beyond belief. Barbecue. We're talking barbecue.
All right, come on. What's the number?
I lost weight.
You did not.
I have. I've lost weight.
You know what, though? That scale might be a little different than ours at home.
Yeah,
not every scale is the same.
It started at zero, and it went up to a certain weight. Okay? Tara writes, she did the prong collar dance with a golden the other day. Wonderful way to introduce it. Fabulous results. We also have pet convincers on the way. Thanks for the seminar on the 3rd in Gainesville. Tara, thank you. Thank you for going. Thank you for being open to the training. Thank you for showing up, and thank you for taking the information, and thank you for coming. I mean, I'm blessed. Over 200 people have come to the RV dog training seminars. 200. Now, I wanted to do 20 in 2015, and I just talked to Cameron on the phone. He runs the company, and Cameron's like, Jeff, you can't do 20. Stop telling people you can do 20 seminars, because we're starting a shadow program at the training center as well. So we're going to do 12. So the goal for 2015,
that's still a ton.
I don't think it is. We're switching them all to 2-day seminars. So we're doing 12 2-day seminars in 2015. So right now we're looking for people up north, meaning New York, Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, Toronto, and out west. If you're a trainer with a training facility and you're interested in hosting, rvdogtrainer.com, what I want you to do is I want you to contact my office, contact Cameron, 401-274-1078. That's 401-274-1078. Talk to Cameron and ask him about hosting it. Now, you get some people out there, some dog trainers out there that own companies that are like, why would I do that? I don't want Jeff coming to my training facility. And then, and they're geared for the public, by the way. So you get all these private people with their dogs that he's going to train all these dogs and they're never going to come back to me. No, that's not how it works. Okay. How it works is this. For instance, Dream Dogs down in Gainesville, Florida. Okay. Rich and Victoria. They hosted my last seminar. We promote the heck out of them. We promote the heck out of them. Then what happens is you get 30 people to come to the training center. Okay. They find out if they didn't know about Victoria before. They see her center. They see the work I do. They open themselves up to balance training. She has tons of programs there. She's a canine good citizen evaluator. She has a trick class. She does remote collar. She wrote a book on remote collar training. Then they're all of a sudden exposed. She gets more business in the long run. It's a business builder, guys. It's a business builder. 4 million dogs a year are being killed in this country. So many people are struggling. Trust me, there's room for everybody. There is room for everybody. Linda, how about a question?
I would love to give you a question.
Thank you.
Hi, Jeff and Linda.
Hello.
I wrote last week about our newly adopted Roddy who kept coming up the leash at us and growling when we tried to control the
dog. I remember that.
I just wanted to tell you that after introducing him to the prong collar, he walks like a dream now. No more growling, pulling, and being a jerk. We've been working hard with him, and I just took him on his first pack walk yesterday with my four dogs, the other dogs. Perfect formation with sitting every time I stop.
Okay. This, a week ago.
Yeah.
A week ago, it was advice.
It was advice. She wrote in.
Guys, so think about this. Somebody write, this is how powerful, this is, we're going to talk about 2 points here. Point is about videos. Remind me about dog trainers making videos. Okay. And the public making videos. Okay. So this is it. This is somebody that called in, wrote into my show last week. Okay. I gave her advice, and in 1 week, she can walk her Rottweiler that used to climb up the leash and bite the leash and try to bite her. She can not only walk that dog by itself, she can walk that dog with four other dogs in a pack. Why? From simple, practical, real world, balanced training advice. So for all the people out there that don't like what I do, guess what, guys? A bit of information. I don't care. Heads up, guys. I don't care. I don't care what you think. For all the people that don't like my videos, guess what? Point of information, newsflash, I don't care. You don't bother me. Do you really think you okay, people send me hate mail. Just to let you know, point of information, guys, I laugh. I laugh. You don't ruin my day. You don't make me unhappy. You actually make me smile. Send me hate mail. You make me smile. Call the radio station and complain about me. You make the head of the radio station smile. They laugh. They laugh. They think it's funny that you call in to complain about my radio show. You know why? I remember there's this one guy, a trainer, and who I've never actually talked to, never even met, never responded to. He sent this really nasty letter to my radio, to the head of the radio station. By the way, his name is Joe Lembo. Joe Lembo. Cumulus Radio. Wampanoag Trail, East Providence, Rhode Island. I don't have the exact address, but for some reason I'm thinking it's 1502 Wampanoag Trail.
I don't know.
And it doesn't matter. But anyway. I went into his office after reading this letter that says, I'm this big dog trainer, and I don't like what Jeff does, and I don't like the advice he gives out, and I've got a big social media presence, and I'm going to destroy him on the air, yada, yada, yada. I went into the radio station, and I sat down with the manager about something else. This guy runs the company. You know what he did to me? He gave me a high five. He gave me a high five. He's like, Jeff, good work. You have to understand that in the radio business, having a hater is actually a compliment. It's actually a compliment. I don't care about you. You know who I care about? Who's the woman that helped her with her Roddy?
Yvonne.
All that matters is Yvonne. That's it. Yvonne is the one that matters. You don't matter. Haters, you don't matter to me. Yvonne matters to me. Why? Because I helped Yvonne's dog. That's all that matters to me. All right. Where are we here? Good, we have time. Tara writes, you need to do one in Wisconsin. It's my hometown. Serious lack of dog trainers up there. Many people with dogs with issues. Tara, find me a location. I will be there. Okay? We need to have 30 people there because we have to generate by, you know, it is a business. I do have an RV. It does cost me $150 a day just in fuel. Okay? All right? So we do have to cover our expenses, and I am away from the office for 2 to 3 months. So, yes, we do have to make money, and making money is not a bad thing out there. For all you people with money issues, that's a whole nother story that we're not going to talk about right now. But we could, but we won't. Okay, Linda. Oh, wait, hold on. Videos. For all you dog trainers out there that watch my videos, but then you say to yourself, well, I don't want to make a video because Jeff's made one, Sean's made one, Blake's made one, Tyler's made one, different people have made one. It's a simple prong collar video. It's a simple heel video. Let me explain something to you. I want every balanced dog trainer, frankly, I want every dog trainer to make wonderful videos about the work you do. Showcase the work. You cannot have enough prong collar videos out there. You cannot have enough videos out there of teaching a dog to sit. You can't. Because I want the public to be able to pick and choose the training style that they want. You know, it's funny because the people that write the most hateful things about me, guess what? They don't have any videos at all. They have no videos. They've got none. Or they got simple videos. There are people out there, it's so funny. Oh my gosh, could you imagine this? Somebody writes a piece of hate mail to me about how I train a leash reactive dog to another dog, okay? So I go to their YouTube channel, and you know what I see? It's the funniest thing. So they write me hate mail about the way I train a leash reactive dog, a dog that gets highly reactive and agitated and lunges at another dog, okay? They write me bad stuff, how I'm doing everything wrong and the tools I'm using, yada, yada, yada.
Wait, stop for a minute.
What?
When you're talking like this, I'm getting all worked up. Like, I can't wait to hear what you're going to say.
Okay, well, be patient, please.
I'm freaking out.
Okay, so I go to their, I don't respond to them. I never respond to anybody because bottom line is, I really don't care. I really don't. If you haven't figured that out about me yet, is if you don't like me, I really don't care. It's just a funny thing that people really think, they think I really care about that. All right. So it's called self-confidence. All right. So I go to their YouTube channel and I see them working with a dog and they have a video of a dog walking by another dog behaving badly. And then that's the before video. And you know what their after video is? Their after video is them walking by a stuffed dog. I kid you not. I kid you not. It is a stuffed dog. It is a fake dog. A fake dog. That's their video. Or someone will use a fake baby. They'll have their dog going by a child and the dog is reactive. And then they show the after video and they get those like 4 foot high Barbie dolls or 4 foot high dolls and they have somebody go doo 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 and they have the dog and they have the dog go by that one quietly. Do you really think the public is that stupid? Do you really think the public is that stupid?
Do they really think a dog is that stupid?
No, but you're being totally ridiculous. You're being totally ridiculous. All right, we'll take a quick break. It's Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. Madly in love with you guys. Having fun. I'm having fun because I'm looking at the thermostat, the thermometer outside. We've got a sensor, and it says 39 degrees, and that makes me really, really happy. But I got a feeling tonight, as we're going to go north, closer to Baltimore, we're probably getting the single digits again. Mm-hmm. That's okay. We'll run the generator all night. Our propane's been doing great too. All right. Coming right back. Welcome back, Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live. I'm in North Carolina today, and we're recording this on Friday, but it is a new show today. If you miss any part of this show, you can watch the show and listen to the show. Watch and listen to the show up on YouTube or on iTunes. We'll do this today. Tomorrow, Saturday, we'll have it up by 6 p.m. Linda, how about another question, please?
Sure. This one is from Barb. One of my dogs has recently started counter surfing, and of course the reward is the food that he gets off the table or counter. Should I use his e-collar and set him up with food near the edge of the table or counter and give him a slightly higher than working level correction when he shows too much interest in the food on the counter? Thank you for all that you do. Because of you and Sean and all of your wonderful free info, I was able to integrate a dog reactive fear rescue dog into our house a year ago with no issues with my other dogs.
Incredible. Incredible. Because of videos. Okay. So she, was it a foster dog or an adopted dog she was able to get?
Adopted.
She adopted another dog?
Yeah.
Okay. Think about that. Okay. 4 million dogs a year. Was there a question in there?
Yeah, the dog is counter surfing.
Okay, counter surfing. We'll go over counter surfing. Okay, thank you. Counter surfing should be active God training. Okay, there's 5 or 6 active God training things you can do. Morgan, I see your question. I'm going to get to you. Let's go over some active God stuff. And if you want to just take this sound clip that I'm going to talk for the next 5 minutes and say all Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training doing is use e-collars on high level of things, feel free to do that and feel free to bash me. My name is Jeff Gellman. The company is Solid Canine Training. Make sure you get all that correct so you feed people to my YouTube channel. All right? There are some things that need to be put up and put up high. Dogs that counter surf could die. Dogs that counter surf could die. I want you to know that it's a very dangerous thing, okay? So this is what you do. Yes, you set your dog up. Put a high value item up on the counter. You can set up a video camera, whether it's a drop cam or something else like that. Then what you're gonna do is when the dog, you have the remote collar on the dog, make sure it's on properly and it fits well. And yes, as soon as that dog goes up on that counter, you give that dog a high level correction for 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. Yes, that dog will scream. Yes, it will hurt. Yes, it will be uncomfortable. I understand that and I respect that and I understand the public's concerns about that. But I want people to know when you have to have something removed from your dog, such as a sock, you can use this for socks as well, women's panties, trash, rocks, a dog toy, raw hides, or a bone, or the dog could eat a chicken or a turkey and the bones can start impaling things, stomachs and intestines. I want you to know, number one, your dog could die. I want you to know that dogs die every year by the tens of thousands from this situation. I want you to know that we can fix this in 3 seconds. Okay, so you decide. 3 seconds of discomfort for your dog. 3 seconds of discomfort. That's it. 1, 2, 3. Or massive discomfort. You have to take your dog to the vet. You have to cut open your dog. The surgery is $3,500 at a minimum. You've got to cut open your dog. There is a risk that your dog will die on the table. There is a risk that the inside injuries are more than what you thought. The recovery time is long, and your dog is uncomfortable during the recovery time. They are uncomfortable prior to the surgery, during the surgery, and after the surgery. There is a high risk of infection. There's also a risk that they have to open the dog back up again. There's a risk that the dog will open up the incisions. and you've got to go back in to the emergency room. And I want you to know that it's $3,500 to actually $5,000 for that surgery. Then I also want you to fully understand that the dog will most likely do it again. Why? Because the surgery doesn't fix the behavior. I want you to know that dogs die every year from this. I feel so strongly about making sure that we stop dogs from counter surfing and from eating socks and from ingesting anything that they're not supposed to. And I want you to also understand that in order to do that, there has to be a high level consequence or the dog will not change its behavior. Someone could say, well, when they see the dog jumping, they say off or leave it, and the dog gets down. I understand that. I understand that. That's great. What I want you to do is I want you to leave the house. I want you to put food up on the counter. I want you to leave the house for an hour, and I want you to see if that works. I want you to see if the dog doesn't go up there. Okay? You can use it for poop eating as well, and you can use it for fence fighting. You can use it for digging holes, and you can use it for ingesting. That's what I want you to do. And that's not the only thing that we use remote collars for. If you want to take that out of context, you're a major a-hole, feel free to. Go ahead. Do it. Won't bother me. Doesn't bother me at all. Doesn't bother me. People come to me because of our training. They come to me because of our training. Morgan asked a good question. Hold on, let me check my time. And my phone shuts off after 15 seconds. Okay. Morgan asks, we got an e-collar training from a company that came from Dallas to Oklahoma City for two-hour sessions with us at home. Our dog, Rowdy, is now great at in-home obedience. However, now when he gets a correction, he usually sits down and scratches the collar contact. And he won't do anything else. Does this mean that the level needs to go down? He started training at a 10 working level. And a few nights ago when I corrected him at level 4, it made Rocky shake his head. Is it possible that his working level is now 2 or 3? Can anyone even feel that level? Okay. You can't feel that level. So actually, what he's doing is he's scratching. And he's scratching probably because it bothers him. That's it. It's just become now an irritant, like a little bug. So you can actually stop that. So you actually might have to go higher. But if he's listening to you, don't worry about it. But the way we also train on remote collars is we don't prompt. Once the dog is trained, we don't prompt anymore. So I don't know how you are trained. Everybody trains a little bit different. Some trainers do constant prompting, and some trainers get the dog technically off the remote collar, and then all they do is they just go to correction if the dog doesn't listen, which is fair. But the working level, is your working level 2 or 3? It might be, but 2 or 3, the dog just might scratch out of habit now. So Morgan, you might actually have to go higher. You can actually correct the scratching, because the scratching might be just for, you know, it might be getting the dog just to stop, trying to get you to stop. So Linda, how about another question?
I have a dog that sniffs around the house constantly looking for food. It is more annoying than anything else. I suspect if he could get out of the crate when I'm not around, he would get to the trash. He eats Purina Pro Plan for large breed puppies. Even when he is full, he just keeps on sniffing and begging from the kids. What do I do?
Don't let him. Stop. Don't. First of all, the brand of dog food that you're feeding, first Morgan says we don't prompt, we only correct if he isn't listening. So Morgan, it sounds like things are probably going well. You might want to try correcting higher. Fiddle with it, Morgan. Fiddle with the remote. You know, but if you go up to 10, 12, 15, that's not that high. It's not that high on a remote. It sounds like you're probably using either Dogtra or e-collar technologies. We love e-collar technologies. The e-collar 300 is the one we use the most. So fiddle around. Try going high, try going low, see what happens. You can also keep a leash on him, and when he starts scratching, you can also pull him out of that environment. But if you don't want your dog sniffing around your house, don't let the dog do it. Stop. Stop letting the dog do it. And of course, if he was out of the crate when you weren't home, he probably would go looking for food. That's what dogs do. Now, what's your activity level with this dog? Do you do any games with this dog? Do you exercise this dog enough? Do you keep its mind and its body, busy? So do something else. So what else do you want to do with the dog? Find something else to do. The dog obviously needs another activity to do. So find it. Okay? Morgan, you're welcome. Okay? Next question, please. Oh, remind me to talk about, remind me to check in my time here. Actually, we don't have time for another question. Yeah, we do. We could do a question. But I want you to remind me to talk about people that don't want to do certain things because they baby their dogs. Let's talk about this. First of all, there's some people out there that like, they won't use a prong collar because they say, well, if I would never put a prong collar on my kid or myself, why would I do it on my dog? I can't imagine a stupider comment than that. Okay, so you won't put a prong collar on you or your kid, so you won't do it on your dog. Do you put a harness on yourself or a harness on your kid? On yourself, I can understand. You know, I've dabbled in the fetish world before, and yeah, I've had a leather harness on, and you know, latex shorts. You know, I've even actually even worn fishnet stockings and high heels to some fetish clubs. You know, I've done all that stuff. You know, I actually met Linda at a fetish club, all right? So I've dabbled in all that. I understand about the harness and the spiked collar. But do you eat out of a food bowl? Do you feed your kids out of a food bowl on the ground? Do your kids or you poop and pee outside? When you go to the doctor and they take your temperature, do they stick a thermometer up your butt? Do you sleep in a kennel on the ground? Where do you buy your mattress from? Petco or a mattress store? You're an idiot when you make those comparisons. Do you know that? Do you realize how silly all that information is? You realize how silly that comment is when you say, I would never put a prong collar on myself or my kids. I won't put it on my dog. That's just stupid. They're dogs. They're not humans. And on that note, when I come back, we're going to really talk about the humanization of dog. Morgan, oh, geez, too much information. Morgan, that's nothing. Okay? That's nothing. All you got to do is Google my name and Google the company Miko. I own a company called Miko, M-I-K-O. It's all on the internet. People always love to. Why are you listening to Jeff? He used to be the adult business. Guess what? Ask any dog trainer what they used to do. You think we were all dog trainers out of the womb? Fools. We're coming right back. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do? Coming back to you live. That was funny. Bring it up the past. I love meeting you that way. It's great. Welcome back, Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning. It's actually Friday. We're over in North Carolina somewhere. We just actually finished putting stickers on the two more stickers. Mm-hmm. We put Georgia and South Carolina stickers on the RV. Actually, I took a picture of the RV calendar on the outside of the RV. You know, when we bought this RV 6 months ago, it only was in two states. It was in Massachusetts and New Hampshire. The RV is actually from New Hampshire. Right now, you'll see all the different states it's been in. It's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. I think by the end of 2015, it's going to be in all 48 states.
Yeah?
I think so. I want to go to Alaska, though. Hawaii, I don't think it'll make it. I don't think it'll make it. So a lot of people talk about they want to treat their dog. You don't understand, Jeff. We don't have any kids, so we treat our dog like a baby. Okay. So let me ask you a question. If you treat your dog like a baby, why is it that you're giving your dog so much freedom? Why do you give your dog so much freedom then? Because I don't know about you, but I would never let my baby out of my eyesight when I was raising it. So when you have a child that's learning how to crawl, don't you put up gates? Don't you keep your child in one room? Don't you always keep your child with you in the same room to make sure that it doesn't get into trouble? So when you make comments like, when you tell me that your dog's peeing on your bed, and I tell you to close your bedroom door, well, that's too hard to do, or sometimes we forget. You forget? Really, you forget to close your bedroom door to keep your dog out of there from peeing?
Maybe they like a pee-pee bed.
But hold on, but I thought you treated your dog like a baby. So let me ask you this question. You're at Target, and your child, your baby, your human baby, if you had a human baby, because you do baby your dog, so let's put it into perspective, guys, right? You take your human baby, if you were raising one, right? But you're raising a dog that you're treating like a baby. All right, I respect that. But you took your human baby and you left it in the shopping cart and you had to go to the bathroom. So in Target, most of the bathrooms are over by the dollar section. They do that, you know, right at the entrance. So you took, what you did was you left your shopping cart with the baby in it outside the bathroom just to run in real quick to go to the bathroom. It'll be fine, right? Won't it be fine? You would never do that, would you? You would never leave your child unsupervised for even probably 60 seconds. I would hope not if you were a responsible person. So why is it that you're not watching where your dog is at all times if you don't have a trained dog? So this baloney that you, the reason why you've got a badly behaved dog, or the reason why you don't have consequences for your dog, is because you're treating it like a baby, is a bunch of baloney. You're lying to yourself and you're actually lying to me, because most responsible parents that I know set up boundaries, consequences, and rules for their children. So, Linda, how about another question, please?
So recently I have heard walks can be rough on a developing puppy. Is it safe for me to take my four-month-old Doxy Beagle for a walk around the block once a day?
Yeah, unless you live in Texas and a block is 10 miles. You've got a 16-week-old. You had a 16-week-old dog. So you had a 16-week-old dog, and it's a small breed dog, which is fine. Goes around the block. I wouldn't be surprised if that took you less than 10 minutes. So yes, it's okay. Once a day?
Yeah.
Yeah. You can do it once a day. You can actually do it twice a day. You can do it twice a day. And I'll tell you why you can do it twice a day. Because if you let that dog out in the backyard and it ran around, it probably would do the same distance as going around your block 10 times a day at a much higher speed. Think about that. Dogs that run around in the backyard travel at a higher speed than you would if you took it for a walk. So if a lot of dogs go to a doggy daycare and they run around all day, they probably do 10 miles. 5 miles at a high rate of speed. So you walking your dog, even when I go running with girl, it's still not anything like when she's playing ball. Oh, I bought a, but did you see the bite sleeve that came in?
Oh yeah. Yep.
At the beginning of this RV tour, I couldn't even get a girl to play tug or to bite anything. And now she bites a puppy sleeve. And I just purchased actually an arm sleeve, and it's really thick, so she's having a hard time getting a full bite on it, but she's getting it. She's getting it.
It's funny to watch.
Yep, she's getting it. I'll make a video of that. I'll make a video of that. Let's see what we got here. Okay, great. How's the trip going?
It's going. It's going pretty well.
Right, yeah, talk louder, honey.
Having a hard time because of my cold talking loudly, but...
I know. But we also want to make sure we don't have mic problems, too.
Yes, that's true.
Right?
I agree, 100%.
So we redid this show. Yeah. We did the show yesterday, and now we're doing the whole show again today. Yep. So let's make sure.
So we had a super good time at Universal Studios, which...
That was fun, huh?
Yeah, it really was. I get kind of weird about those places. I don't want to say anxious, well, maybe that's the word.
Theme parks?
Theme parks and rides and tons of crazy people. But it was pretty good.
It wasn't that busy at all.
No, it wasn't. Rides we waited a while, but some we only waited for 5 or 10 minutes.
Well, what does a while mean? Because
maybe a couple of them were for like 45 minutes. Yeah.
So during peak season there, like during the Christmas season, where we almost went there, the original plan was to actually go there during the Christmas break because we were down there. 2 to 3 hour waits at lines.
Yep.
2 to 3 hour waits.
No, that would not have gone well.
Could you imagine that?
No. I can't. I can't even imagine how upset I would be to be waiting that long.
2 to 3 hour waits. It'd be out of control.
Yeah, and how are you supposed to get on the rides? I mean, you'd have time for what, 5 rides?
And you know, it's funny because those two, you guys went on those 2 water rides,
mm-hmm.
the Jurassic Park ride and then the log ride.
Yep.
A lot of those, like the Jurassic Park ride, a lot of the boats were only half full.
Yeah.
It was pretty incredible.
And we only waited for about 10 minutes for that Jurassic Park ride.
Yeah, which is great.
And we waited about 10 minutes for the log ride.
Yeah, that looked like
terrifying. Terrifying.
I put up a little video of Angela. So I didn't get to go on any of the rides. I hung out with Angela all day. They really should have a pass. So it's $135 to go to, we wanted to go to for Harry Potter World. The big gist of it was Harry Potter World. So there's Universal Studios now is broken up into 2 sections. So you can go to one of the parks for $95 and you can go to both of them for $135. And since there's Harry Potter on both sides, plus you get to take that, what's that train called?
Hogwarts.
The Hogwarts Express, which is really, really cool, by the way. It really is fun. Between the two parks.
Did you see Angelo's face on that train?
He was amazed.
He looked so worried.
Yeah, well, because of the stuff going on.
He was like, he was so serious.
He has a serious. It's such a serious face. Morgan, thanks for the feedback. Still sounding good. Good. So it looks like we fixed the microphone issue, and then next week we're back in the booth. Next week we're back in the studio. So, it's important. Oh, what was I going to say here? Oh, so they should have. So I didn't get to go on any of the rides. I hung out with Angelo all day. They really should have a special price for someone that has to hang out with an infant all day.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of a family that can't go on the rides, but.
I know, maybe you get like a special bracelet or something or whatever.
Yeah.
So they can tell.
Right. I don't know.
Whatever.
Anyway, but we didn't mind it. It was still a good investment.
But you went on that one ride with him.
So I went on this one. We hung out at this like little playground area and they have this children's water ride. But I don't think it's geared for 2-year-olds.
No, because you made me get on that thing. I was so scared.
But Angelo got on and I said, Angelo, hold on tight. And he held on to these 2 little handles, and I got behind him, and I did put my legs around him. And we went down it, and there's video of that on Facebook.
And he's screaming his head off when he comes out.
But then you go around the curves.
It gets dark for a couple of seconds.
Yeah.
In the dark.
But it was fun.
Yeah.
I think that was his first official. I mean, he goes down slides, but this was his.
That was a real
that's
ride.
A ride. That's yeah. a ride.
But
so.
He was too short to go on any of, even like the little kid rides. He couldn't really go on those. You have to be 36 inches.
I know. But that's a fun place. Universal Studios is a fun place.
Next time, we stay for 2 days.
We'll stay for 2 days.
We should have stayed for 2 days.
I know.
Oh, wow.
We could have.
I know.
But then we wouldn't have gone up to Greenville.
Right. Which was fun.
Right. Which was probably more worth it.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to – the next year's this year's 2015 RV tour is going to be scheduled a little bit different because now we're going back to Providence where it's 0 degrees. So I think what we're going to do – is next year, Linda wants to be home for Christmas, like the week of Christmas. So we're still going to go out to the West Coast for Thanksgiving. We'll still probably do Dallas, Austin, Phoenix. We should probably do something on the West Coast. And then I think what we'll do is we'll head back to Rhode Island for, we'll head back on Rhode Island for Christmas week.
We got to negotiate that.
And then we'll do Christmas week there. We'll do Christmas week there. And then in February, mm-hmm. We should not be in Rhode Island for January,
no,
February.
Those are prime snowstorm months.
I know.
Cold.
It's not even snowstorm. Snow, it's cold.
Snow, ice. I know. Everything that's miserable.
I know. Tara writes, most of the theme parks have baby swap areas. Yep. Just have to ask. It's a special section for parents. When one goes on, the other parent gets to go in the front and swap the young child and go for themselves. I think we did that. I did that one time, Tara. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. But that's great. That's great
for a roller coaster. You did it.
Was it a roller coaster?
Yeah. Yep.
Huh. We're going to take a quick break. This is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, our weekly call and radio show. What would Jeff do? It's heard around the world. God, we got to be over like 80 countries right now. The show is heard. But let's get another question lined up. We're coming right back. Why are you hitting me?
I don't know. It's good
fun. I'm getting hungry.
My stomach is growling audibly.
I know.
Did you hear it?
Yeah. Yeah. Welcome back. Did you have a babysitter yet?
No.
Oh.
I have two possibilities that I'm going to be meeting.
Oh, cool. Mm-hmm. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with our weekly call and radio show, What Would Jeff Do? The great thing about this show is that it's also seen now on YouTube. And one thing we're going to do in 2015 is for all my advertisers, first of all, my advertisers, I thank you so much. You guys are all great. Is we want you guys to do a 60-second or a 30-second commercial, a video commercial. And then during the breaks, we're going to actually run commercials right on the video feed, which will be really, really cool. That's going to be cool.
Yeah.
That's going to be cool. So when we take a break, when we're in the studio taking a break, we actually can run commercials, which is going to be really exciting. But how about another question?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Please, I need help. I have a female boxer Great Dane mix. She's almost 2 years old. Last year, she jumped through a window and sliced through tendon in back left knee due to this injury. We let her stay in our bedroom to separate her from our male pit bull.
Okay.
They play well, but the leg gives her trouble. Anyway, it started not too long ago. When my wife was sitting close to me, she tries to wedge herself between us now. She's gotten to where if my wife touches or talks to me, she stands there and barks at my wife. Now she started jumping and nipping at her if my wife gets up to leave the room. Mm-hmm. Is this jealousy or is there a deeper problem? Any suggestions would be greatly appreciated.
Well, yes, it's a problem. Let's not use the word jealousy. You know, who really cares if it's jealousy or not? Let's just call it bad behavior. Bad behavior. So what you can do is this. First of all, I need to get this dog away from your wife, okay, when you guys are together, because it will escalate. So what's next, most likely what's next is your dog is going to bite, most likely. We see this all the time. I want to scare you. It doesn't mean it's going to happen, but I don't like the progression of this, okay? I don't like how this is progressing, all right? I don't like how this is progressing. So we're going to teach your dog the place command. We're going to teach your dog a good downstay. And you're going to also start doing some good leadership skills. And at the beginning, what I want you to do is everything is permission-based. Every aspect of your life with your dog right now should be based on permission. Your dog shouldn't be allowed to get away with anything or do anything without permission. Eating, going through doors, in and out of its kennel. Let's keep that dog off the furniture right now. I want you to also do some games with the dog where you engage the dog, not the dog engages you. But for a dog to quote unquote wedge itself between you, that's freaking rude. That is bottom line, unacceptable, rude behavior. That should not be going on at all. So let's stop that right away. So let's start with that. But it happens a lot. It happens all the time. It gets out of control. So I'm glad you caught it now. But you can see how it's escalating. You can see that it started with just nudging and then barking. And then next thing you know, you're going to have lunging and the dog's going to be jumping up on you. So a lot of times people, they're afraid to go hardcore at the beginning. But next thing you know, you're getting rid of your dog. 4 million dogs a year are dying, guys. They're being killed. 4 million dogs a year are being killed. And there's probably got to be another 20, 30 million dogs a year that are still, that are in homes, but are just not doing very, very well at all. Not doing well at all. So. How about another question, Linda?
Yes. So I have a 2-year-old Jack Russell Cross Chihuahua. I've had him since he was 8 weeks old and trained him myself. He is house trained in the sense that he knows he has to do his business outside, and he is very good at doing this. The problem I have is that he has become afraid of my husband for some reason. He's not afraid all the time, like he will sit with us in the evening and generally acts normal when we are all here. However, every so often he will cower down like he is afraid of my husband and pee on the floor. This afternoon we came back and my husband went in the house to let him out for a pee, and then he cowered down and peed on the kitchen floor for no reason at all. Sometimes when my husband speaks to him, he will cower away, ears down, and tail between his legs, and we have no idea why. He has done this for a while now, and it's slowly becoming an issue as I can't leave them alone together because I don't know if he is going to get afraid and pee. Any suggestions how I can help this behavior? It's becoming ridiculous now.
Excuse me. Yeah, it sounds like you've got a really nervous, fearful dog. Sometimes our good intentions turn bad. So what I would do is what's the level of excitement in the house? Believe it or not, sometimes people try too hard. What they do is they have a nervous, fearful dog, and then they use, then they, what they do is they get the dog into an excited state. They get the dog into an excited state because they think that's going to help, right? Well, oh, he's afraid of things. I want to get him all excited. I want him to think that life is fun. That could be too much for the dog. And then obviously now the dog is peeing. So let's find out what's going on. Let's keep the household calmer. Let's also get your husband to do a lot more stuff for the dog. Let's get your husband to do all the feeding with the dog. Let's get your husband to do a lot of training with the dog, making sure that your husband is taking the dog for walks, making sure your husband is doing a lot of leadership skills. And then what you're going to do is you're going to see most likely some much better results. So let's do that. But don't try too hard. Sometimes we try too hard to be quote unquote friends, you know, with the dog. So let's be really, really careful about that. Okay?
Sounds good.
Yeah, let's do another question.
How should I keep my 60-pound, 2-year-old Siberian Husky while at work? Just rescued this 2-year-old, tall, beautiful boy from the local animal shelter, underweight and full of love. I work from home 3 days a week so I can walk him, run him, and play with him. However, I'm at a loss on what to do the 2 days I'm at the office. I've left him in the garage, and he chewed up everything he could get his mouth on. We are in a remodel, so I'm worried about him chewing on electrical, etc., that could be harmful. I'm worried about leaving him in the backyard because I know he can easily clear the fences.
Right.
I've read up on crate training, but just can't stomach keeping him in a tiny cage for 8 to 10 hours of the day. Would love your suggestions.
Okay. Jeff. All right. So first of all, thank you for rescuing, first of all. Okay. Let's think about this logically. Okay. Let's think about this logically. What I'd like you to do is this. While you're home with the dog, what I'd like you to do is make sure that you are teaching that dog also how to be calm. But first of all, you got to get that dog in a crate. You have got to get the dog in the crate. 8 to 10 hours in the crate, yeah, that's not acceptable. But it's going to be less time in the crate because you're going to either hire a dog walker or your dog's going to go to doggy daycare. That's just the way it's going to be because you're not going to be able to keep this dog in a crate for 10 hours. You won't. That's really, really pushing it. So what I want you to do is I want you to teach that dog, though, that when you are home, that there is play time, so it's active time, and then there's also calm time. And you, the human, decide when that is. So I want the dog to learn, even if you're home, that everything is not just fun, fun, fun. I want the dog to learn how to be calm. So I want to make sure that you teach that dog how to be calm. How do you do that? You do that through duration work. And people are like, oh, geez, I don't want to have a lazy dog. It's a highly energized dog. Let me see if I can put the camera up. Oh, girl just got up. Girl, pots. Good. Okay, so that's girl right there. She was just sleeping, and then I just woke her up. So girl is a highly, highly, high energy, active dog. This morning, what we did, geez, I wonder if that's what messed up the sound last time. Move these cords out of the way now. As a highly, highly active, high energy dog. Something came unplugged here. There we go. And she has not been on a walk today. I have not even run her today. She woke up, went to the bathroom, ate breakfast, and then we took off. And we drove for 2 hours, and now we've been here for about an hour and a half. She's not gone on a run. That's got nothing to do with her, though, lying down and going to sleep and being relaxed. Why? Because we practice it all the time. When I mean practice, it's we live it all the time. That's our lifestyle. We have high energy play. We also do walks. We also do training. But guess what? You're in an RV. We also have to relax. What I'd like you to do is I'd like you to find a dog walker or a doggy daycare to go to. So you need to find a dog walker or a doggy daycare to go to, because, and you need to crate train your dog. You should not be leaving your dog in the garage. Why? Your dog will die. That is why. I'm telling you now, your dog will eat something and your dog will die. Your dog will chew through the sheetrock. Your dog will eat electrical wires that are live.
Drink antifreeze.
Your dog will drink antifreeze or oil or gasoline, or your dog will turn on something that will eventually explode and your dog will die. And to me, that's a heck of a lot more meaner than learning how to crate train your dog. If you don't have the money for doggy daycare, which is about $20 to $25 a day, that's 2 days a week, that's $50 a week. Get a second job or come up with a revenue stream or cut down your expenses somewhere else. Cut down your expenses somewhere else. But we're doing a home remodel. $50 a week, $50 a week, that's $2,500 a year. Maybe you're going to have to cut down on the expense of your home remodel. And for the next year, pay for doggy daycare. It's all about choices. It's all about choices. So sometimes people just don't want to make the choices, though. You know, I gotta check my time. We're gonna take a quick break. This is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Mm-hmm. Yep. Welcome back. Actually, welcome back to our sixth year. Our sixth year of the What Would Jeff Do show. 6 years we've been doing this show.
I haven't been here from the beginning, though.
No, you haven't. Nope, you haven't. But you're probably the reason why most people listen to the show.
Wow, what are you gonna do?
I know, they love you. They love you. But Cumulus Radio, thank you so much for renewing our contract. It's funny because we're not radio people. I'm not a radio person. But
you got a face for radio.
I do have a face for radio. Thank you. My wife tells me that. My mom doesn't, though, but my wife does. Thank you. I appreciate that. That's why you married me, right?
It's just a joke.
That radio face.
It's just a joke.
I know it is, honey. I know it is. But I want to. We're really excited to be in our sixth year of this radio show, the What Would Jeff Do show. This show started just on a whim, just on an idea. And a lot of people say, oh, geez, I wish I could do this. You know, a lot of people should be setting their goals. They shouldn't be making New Year's resolutions. Resolutions don't work. Goals work. So goal is you have to write it down. So say, and you should only do maybe 3 or 4 goals for the year.
Do you remember I tried to give up swearing?
That's a ridiculous goal. There should be 3 or 4 goals for the year. And I'm doing a personal goal, a business goal, and
a marriage goal, a family goal.
So, and then in each of those categories, I've got a couple of them, but there's pretty much one big goal. And then on the goals, what you do is every day you have to do something that's leading to that goal. So if you say to yourself, well, I want my marriage to be better. I want better communication with my spouse. But every day at night, you turn on the TV and you watch movies all night and you don't have a conversation with your spouse. How is that exactly making a better relationship with your spouse? You're not doing anything. If you say to yourself, well, I want to start saving money, but every week you're shopping every week, you're going to bars every week, you're doing online shopping and you're spending money, and it's okay to spend money, but you're not saving any money. So how exactly are you going to attain, you know, savings? So if you say to yourself, I want to lose 10 pounds by the end of the year, but every day you're eating junk food and drinking soda, and you're not exercising, how exactly is that going to reach, you know, your goals? So you write your goals down, and then every day you should be doing something, even something small. And for some people out there, that's actually even just saying hello to your spouse. You know, there's a lot of marriages out there where there's just no communication. There's no communication at all. So, and being a dog trainer, a family dog trainer, I see a lot of lack of communication with animals, but also lack of communication with families as well. So, Linda, how about another question?
I have a 9-month-old male boxer pit ridgeback mix named Archer. He's 45 pounds. He has grown up with my other mutt, River, who was fairly aggressive towards him when I first brought Archer home. So my problem that I'm hoping you can help me fix is that when we go to the dog park, Archer zeroes in on any dog younger than him. I think that is the connecting factor and attacks them. He has never seriously hurt another dog, but it is really bad behavior and is quite embarrassing for me as his owner. How can I work to change his behavior towards other dogs? What sorts of training techniques would help him? He is really such a sweet boy to the people and dogs that he knows and trusts, but he can also be aggressive towards people he doesn't know that come into our home. River, my older dog, is 2 years old, and I found her as a stray near the highway. She has had some serious behavioral issues that we have overcome, such as separation anxiety and fear-based aggression.
Wow, cool.
However, she can also be aggressive towards strangers that come into her space. She is great with children and friends and most dogs, though. What I'm trying to ask in this rambling post is, how can I work with my dogs to make them less aggressive towards strangers and, in Archer's case, other dogs? Thank you.
All right. Well, first of all, number one, kudos to you for working at all these issues for so long and for overcoming so many issues. I mean, kudos to you. But what I want you to do, though, is I want you to stop taking your dogs to dog parks. I can't imagine a worse place to take your dog to. I would never take a dog to a dog park. Dog parks are filled with bad behaved dogs, potentially sick dogs, and a lot of irresponsible people and unknowledgeable people about dog behavior. A lot of people, they take their dogs to a dog park because why? You know, it makes them feel good to see their dogs have fun, but a lot of times some of that fun is actually not fun for the dog. And a lot of dogs are getting attacked at dog parks. A lot of dogs are picking up diseases at dog parks. Most dog parks are too small. I mean, I guess if you found a 10-acre enclosed park with off-leash trails and a water source, I guess that could be good. You know, I guess that could be good. So, but your average dog park is about the size of a small parking lot, and it's not big enough. There's not enough room for dogs to move around, and there's usually dog fights. And the same people keep going back again, and everybody's ignoring their dogs. What I'd like you to do with your dog that's beating up on smaller dogs is don't let your dog do it. And what you need to do is you need to find somebody that works with packs of dogs like ourselves. So if you've got somebody out there that works with a balanced pack, they can teach your dog how to greet and be greeted. So your average dog owner does not understand, you know, how to greet a dog or have a dog be greeted by other dogs. So when you go to someone that does a lot of socialization, they fully understand that. So what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to find a balanced trainer by you, and you can go to the International Association of Canine Professionals, which is canineprofessionals.com. You can go to that website and you can search your area for a dog trainer by you that can help you. So that's what I would recommend. I would recommend that. As far as fear-based stuff, what I want you to do is I don't want you to put a lot of pressure on your dog. So sometimes a lot of people put too much pressure on their dogs, and then what happens is the dogs react with fear. So try those things first. I want to thank everybody for listening to the show this week. I want to wish everybody a happy new year. And I want to thank everybody again for the wonderful birthday greetings that they gave me this week online. I really appreciate everybody's constant support of not only this radio show, but Solid Canine Training as a company. Kudos to my incredible staff who are keeping my company going very, very strong. And then also for the people that actually, you know, spread the word about our company and our videos, and for all the support we've gotten in our RV dog training tour. It's been pretty incredible. It's really been incredible. So my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do? I've been talking to you live this Saturday morning. It's actually Friday. We're in North Carolina. You're listening to it on Saturday. And you can listen to the show or watch the show on YouTube anytime you want. It gets uploaded there. Madly in love with you guys, and we'll talk to you soon.